Welcome to everybody. This is the first open conference for our Horizon 2020 UMEPART project. We will use this first session basically for an introduction, an overview, and we will explain what we... My only concern is my colleagues know how sad I feel for having this online sessions. Hopefully this will be the last time, and in September we will get back to normal in presence events. Before my introduction, I will anyhow leave the floor to the Dean of the Faculty of Communication, my faculty, at Ulm University, Professor Luca Barbarito, for his introduction. And
thank you, Andrea. And welcome to all our guests. We regret not to have you at the Ulm University, but we hope in September, in the next future, you could come and visit our university. I'm very glad of this invitation of Andrea to give the start to this open conference. And I just want to underline that I do like a lot this kind of project, because just of one reason, one very simple reason. I think you have chosen an important topic to research, and it's very difficult in research to discriminate what is important and what is not. But for sure, the role of platform in Europe and all over the world became, or we understood, it's extremely relevant. Platforms are not only a business model, a way in which company operate with society and do business, but do have an effect on our life, do have an effect of our culture, and do have an effect on the way we will behave in the future. So, for sure, not only from a sociological point of view, I think you have picked up an extremely important project, and I'm proud that European Union give you the funder to research on that. I'm grateful to Andrea also for being able to put together such a partnership with all of you from different countries of Europe, Italy, Germany, Bulgaria, Spain, Belgium, Turkey, Greece, Portugal, Sweden, Czech Republic, I see. And I also have seen that the organization of your work is extremely good. The different steps in which you have divided your research is extremely consistent, and for this reason, I just want to wish you a good work, and I will push you to put all your effort and all your intelligence to find a solution and to propose also, if you want, regulation, and not only to let's say to start to describe what will going on and what went on because of platformization, but also to propose something that could be useful, socially useful for Europe and for all we citizens. Thank you. Have a good work. Thank you, Andrea. And I hope to look carefully to the registration of this conference in the next days.
Thank you, Luca. By the way, Luca is the dean of the faculty. He is also an economist, mostly working on media economics, and therefore we will discuss again these issues with Luca as a scholar rather than the dean of the faculty when it will come to the economic externalities of platforms, for sure. So thank you very much for your presence and for your time. From my side, I will not use this slot until 11 a.m. I will simply use a few minutes. I think I should switch to the presentation mode, I guess, so as to give you some information about the day, the conference and some general overview on the project, on the main ideas behind the project. Obviously, we will not share with you all the technicalities, which might be quite boring. I don't know if I think it's working, right? You can see the screen. Can you?
Yes.
Okay, thanks. Okay, those are actually the details of the project. We just started in March. It's a 3-year project. And as Luca was saying, I have to say that yes, all research tasks and topics are important. Some of them we can say are more important than others, and here we are exactly talking about the role of platforms in building, or maybe not building, or even preventing the rise of a common European culture, which is obviously a main issue. I will go back to this in a few minutes. I will just tell you something about the idea behind the day, the first open conference. Today, basically, our project is a very, I have to say, and Nico Carpentier, who is here, is one of the main responsible for that. It's a very theoretical project. It's a very theoretical project. This is very complicated because, on the other hand, we also have to come out with some operational remarks and recommendations to the European Commission, as Luca was mentioning, also because this is, as you can see, here a research and action, which means you need to prove that your theoretical result can actually fit real concrete cases. Today, we will put to the test three main frameworks among many others we will use. The first one in the morning, I don't know if Nico would agree on that. As a sociologist, I would say is the agency side of the process, which means one of the main claims, one of the main problems about Europe is exactly the idea that Europeanization is a top-down process, that Europe is all about institutions and bureaucracy, there's no sharing of ideas, there's no common culture, people in the 27 countries do not feel represented by their representative in Brussels. Today, we will start with the idea of working on the Europeanization process as a grassroots and, let's say, bottom-up process. Nico Carpentier will discuss with the two main authors in the field, Charlotte Galpin and Donatella Della Porta. And I'm also quite, I think that it's very promising, the discussion between them and Barbara Thomas, who is part of our team along with Nico, and who in the other end is an authority in the field of media regulation, European and national media regulation, which means here we'll have the encounter between these two perspectives. Europeanization on the institutional side of Europeanization and the grassroots spontaneous side of Europeanization. As a sociologist, I would say agency and structure. We can say top down and bottom up, but this is really promising, and we simply have to thank Nico for the beautiful session he set up for us. The second framework is the one I have to say I deeply used for drawing the project, and he's the, let's call it, the long duration historical model and the world system model, which means working on the European culture by considering Europe as big as Europe might be, considering European history as part of a longer and bigger history, which obviously is the history of global capitalism and the world system. Today, we will discuss with Donald Sassoon. As you know, Donald Sassoon is perhaps not an influential, the most influential work, the most influential scholar in the field of comparative European history. The framework we will happen to discuss in the afternoon is the closest we have to the specific field of media studies. After Allin and Mancini's 2004 seminal book, we refer to this as the media systems model. Our member Stylianos Papathanassopoulos, who is one of the most important scholars in that field, will discuss directly with Allin and Mancini. So this for the day, which is a lot, I have to say. Now, a few words about the project, about how we mean and we will try to use these theoretical models. This is us, by the way. As Luca was saying, and as you can easily infer for this list, we tried to have a good geographical balance and coverage with north, south, east, and west. We also have one partner, which is outside the European Union, which is the Bilkent University in Ankara. And we are very curious about results coming from Turkey, because we really don't know anything about what is happening there. Last general thing is about the scientific board. I have to say, today we will meet three members of the scientific board in the alphabetic order: Daniel, Allin, Paolo Mancini, and Donald Sassoon. It's a pleasure for me to mention also the other members of the board, which will be invited during the next public events. So those are some people among the people you will meet in our upcoming public events: Bogusław Adobek Ostrowska from Poland, Patrice Flichy from France, Peter Golling from UK, Jocky Hermes from Amsterdam, Daniel Ipkins from Exeter, Zizi Papacharissi, you may know her from the Social Media and Society Journal and Conference, Walter Quattrociocchi, who is a well-known computer scientist, Giuseppe Righeri, and Tiziana Terranova. Among the others, we will have the pleasure and the honor, I have to say, to discuss with them. The project is based on a structure that I will not discuss. I will not go into the operational details of the work packages, because this would be quite boring. I will simply try to, look to the big picture and to explain the idea behind these five research work packages. Then from 6 to 9, we are obviously talking about the mandatory work packages related to dissemination, ethics, and management requirement from the project. Europeanization and European media landscape. That was the goal. Europeanization is the process. Media landscape, let's say, is the synchronic situation we have to deal with, which we translated into the platform idea, the platform system idea Luca Barbarito was mentioning. I have to say that everything actually started for me exactly with Donald Sassoon, and we'll go back to Donald Sassoon in the afternoon. The last time Sassoon was with us in Ulm, we had a beautiful discussion about his work on the modern European culture. And in this book, of 2006 book, Sassoon came out with the idea that actually a proper European culture does not even exist. Because what is very common is that in 19th and 20th century, this is obviously the specific topic of the book and of Sassoon's research, broadly speaking, what people do is basically to consume local, which means national contents, and global contents. Basically, the idea, which you can also find in another book by Donald Sassoon, today we will discuss with him about his last book, The Anxious Triumph, but the idea is that basically Europeans do not know each other because they don't know each other, they don't know the other's songs, movies, TV shows, and so on. Which means, basically, I will repeat the usual metaphor I come out with. I started to consider the global culture systemic perspective as a sort of ellipsis which moves around two different centers. These two centers being national media and national cultural industries and global cultural industries. The difference with respect of Sassoon is that, in my opinion, it's not that true that the second center is always the United States. It is very often the United States, but I think the rule is that what is normal, common, and frequent is to have these two main courts or centers or foci around which these cultural ellipses revolves, which means national culture and global culture. National culture is comedies, is comics, is news, is daily entertainment, is information, national broadcasting, national TV channel, national cultural products, and comedies. And the global one, which is basically the hegemonic country in each specific cultural field. The resulting question would be, where is Europe, obviously? It's not normal for Europeans to have a European culture. Basically, what Europeans have is national culture and a global culture, which is usually American. Today, we have the same problem with platforms. As you know, there is only one notable exception, which is Spotify. But besides Spotify, all influential, dominant platforms in cultural markets are American. So the question basically is, try to work on European culture as a sort of geocultural pattern, which barely exists in this continuum between the national and the global. The other fundamental lesson for me was another of us, which will happen to discuss with us, which is Franco Moretti. And Franco Moretti basically tried to apply the idea of space to cultural patterns by somehow merging geographical space, which is Fernand Braudel and long duration history, and the social space, which is obviously Pierre Bourdieu and his idea of field. And according to him, we should consider Europe in a specific way, which means, traditionally speaking, we have the idea of unified Europe. Well, that's okay, Curtius. We have the idea of Europe being made of many differences, which is the Europe of national states, and national cultural productions. Otherwise, we can consider Europe as part of the world system, where his idea, and obviously we are talking about the well-known Atlas of European novel, is that you have different Europes, different geographical pattern according to the specific form you are studying. As many geographies as there are cultural patterns. So this is basically the idea behind the project, which is the Europe of newspaper. Of newspapers is the Europe of many countries. The Europe of movies is a very complicated chessboard with very different situation in it. We have national successes, we have auteur movies moving from one country to another, we have American blockbuster. And then obviously the idea is to try to understand which kind of Europe digital platforms are contributing to shaping. The idea basically is that every form has a geography. So where is Europe? According to Donald Sassoon, there is no Europe in that people consume national contents and global contents. According to Franco Moretti, there is one Europe, but this Europe is made of a specific center, which obviously will be Paris in the case of literary market. And how about the Europe of movies? And how about the Europe of Netflix? And how about the Europe of YouTube? All in all, this is the main research question behind the project. Which is the effect of digital media and digital platform on European culture? Obviously, we also came across Jérôme Bourdon's comparative work on European TV systems, and obviously we came across a claim for pan-European media, and we came across Allin and Mancini's model we will discuss in the final session of this conference. According to Allin and Mancini, there are three models three ways to the European media system: liberal, democratic, corporatist, and the last one, which is the Mediterranean model. We will discuss this in the afternoon, so I will simply try to share with you the main idea. And the main idea is try to combine these two different perspectives. First one, horizontal, synchronic, the media as geocultural pattern. How wide is Europe when you look at Europe by considering the perspective of newspapers or magazines or TV news or TV movies or video sharing platform? And obviously we will have different levels. We will work on national, regional, European, and global. We will not work on the local level, which is very relevant, but we don't have enough time for that. And obviously the idea again is that the blind spot in media as geocultural patterns is exactly the European media. How normal is for, I don't know, let's say for Belgian people to read, I don't know, Austrian novels? It's not frequent. It's not frequent. This is obviously the main issue. If we look at this, Moretti and Brodel and Sassoon and Bourdieu, then we had to consider the vertical level accounting for the process, evolving media landscapes, and we used the idea of platformization. This is an idea we had along with my Ulm colleague and Umeblatt member Guido Ferilli. I think Guido is with us today. And the idea was to select the platformization as a key process. Obviously, I have to say, I'm quite critical as a researcher about platform economy and platform society theories. I don't like those theories that much, but I have to say it's a main keyword, is a keyword that the European Commission itself identified as a main area of interest 5 or 6 years ago. And I mean, we have to face reality, and therefore the idea is to try to consider in which way platformization is changing this cultural and media landscape. By and large, these will be my last words. We have three main moments to consider. The first work package is about the historical background. So we are already working on aggregated data related to media markets in all European countries in for what has to do with magazines, TV, radio, obviously then the penetration of ICT, the web, and social media, and the distribution of movie market. The idea is to have a sort of assessment of how European, how connected, how separated, how national, how global the different media markets in the continent used to be before media platformization. Basically, we are working in the time span is 1905 to 2020, will be 1986 to 2020 in the case of movie market, because there is a lot of data available in that case. Then we will study three main platformization processes, which are related to the main issues for us. First one is platformization of news. Second one is platformization of video. Third one will be the platformization of representations. So very shortly, work package two will be about platformization of news. So we will work on the discussion on social media, YouTube, Twitter and Facebook, related to European issues, in order to somehow verify whether or not there is a sort of common agenda in the 10 countries represented in the consortium, which is, I mean, the majority ideas related to important European issues in the 10 countries. And obviously, we will also have a specific task on fake news, which is basically mandatory in our times. Our package 3 will be about platformization of videos. Therefore, we will work in the 10 countries in, we will study what people watch on Amazon, on Netflix, on YouTube, and then on platforms which are specific to some countries or areas. And the idea, once again, is to try to understand whether or not these platforms are making European culture more or less European. It's now more frequent for, I don't know, for an Italian to have a wider experience of contents coming from, I don't know, Norway or Spain or Finland or Denmark, question mark. The work package 4 will be about bottom-up discussion in social media on two very important and relevant issues, which are gender and migration. And once again, try to compare public discussion in the 10 countries in order to understand in which way and to which extent the public discussion, the emergence of these issues, is favoring or rather threatening the stability of European Union as a sort of cultural global institution. What is very difficult, in my opinion, is to combine the quantitative side. Obviously, we will have plenty of data and data extraction from social media in work packages 2 and 4 with the analytical interpretation and with the theoretical and qualitative side. This is why I have worked with this with Nico Carpentier. We eventually decided for having a final work package. Those will be really my last words for this morning, in which the idea is exactly to use all the results we will collect for trying to ask some very theoretical issues related to what we consider to be the main emergencies and the most important issues for European identity, which means surveillance, algorithm, public debate, technological innovation, and gender. This will be a totally theoretical work package. And the idea is not, obviously, we cannot say that we will work on the before platformization and after platformization, because this wouldn't make any sense. We will consider the state of the art after the platformization process has taken place in Europe. And obviously our idea, so I will go back to what Luca was saying at the very beginning, our idea is actually that digital platforms are a sort of institutional political power per se. And which means that the encounter on the the conflict between the European Union as a cultural pattern and digital platform being other cultural platform is a really fundamental question for the years to come. So basically, this is the idea. I will simply thank all the partners we have, because the truth is that we won this call exactly because we have a beautiful network. This is the state of the research group for the moment. I think that universities are still hiring. By the way, as Ulm University, we are hiring ourselves, and we will hire some postdoc researchers for this project. So if you are interested, please check our website and the usual mailing lists. Okay, this is all for the general presentation. For the general presentation, and I think I don't know if Nico can hear me, but I would say that we have 15-20 minutes for a coffee, and then we can start with your with the session you will share.
Okay, let's have
a first break. Thank you to everybody.